Very good evening to each one of you. On behalf of the Bangalore Chamber of Industry and Commerce, we welcome each one of you to this webinar on introducing competition law, how it can help or destroy a business. This session has been organized under the aegis of Banking, Finance and Corporate Affairs Expert Committee of BCIC. We would like to specially thank Dr. K.V. Om Prakash, Chair of the Committee, and advocate and founder director of Consortia Consulting, and also Mr. N. Venkatakrishnan, mentor of this committee and executive vice president and CFO of Tata Hitachi Construction Machinery Company, for curating this session for the benefit of our members at this crucial period. The speaker for today's session is Mr. M.M. Sharma, head practice antitrust law and competition law of BSS Associates Advocates. A brief profile of Mr. Sharma. He has over 30 years of experience, including judicial experience as a judge advocate in the Indian Navy. He has worked in the Competition Commission of India as additional registrar and was responsible for drafting the implementing regulations under the Competition Act 2002. Mr. Sharma advises and represents clients as an independent counsel on competition and antitrust issues such as cartel abuse of domain, dominant position and M&A before the CCI and in appeals before the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, High Courts, etc. Apart from that, he writes on competition issues. His articles on competition issues are published in noted journals and financial newspapers such as Economic Times, Business Standard, Financial Express, and is frequently quoted on competition issues in leading financial newspapers. He also appears on TV interviews in CNBC, TV18, Zee Business, Magic Brick, ETV News, etc. as subject expert. He is widely regarded as a subject expert in various companies of Apex business such as FICCI, CII, Associate, PhD. Mr. Sharma also runs an independent blog, the Antitrust and Competition Law blog, which gives the latest updation on competition issues in cases in India. The session will be moderated by Mr. Dr. K. V. Om Prakash, Chairman of the Banking, Finance and Corporate Affairs Expert Committee of BCIC. On behalf of the BCIC, we express our sincere thanks to Mr. M.M. Sharma for accepting our invitation to address on this important subject. We would also like to thank all the participants for joining for today's session. We request all of you to kindly mute your mic and webcam options. This is to enhance and keep the bandwidth strong, as well as avoid any disturbance in the background. Please post your questions in the chat box only. Also be viewing the chat box for any specific instructions given by the organizer from time to time. The speaker will respond to the questions during the session. May I now invite Dr. K.V. Om Prakash to set the context for today's subject and also moderate the session. Thanking you once again to all of you. Over to you, Om Prakash, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome all of you for this wonderful session, which is going to be addressed by Mr. M.M. Sharma ji, who has accepted our invitation immediately, and he also heads an organization by name Wise Associates in the competition law space. I would like to recognize the presence of the President Parshuram. Sir, you are there, sir? Parshuram, sir.
Good evening, Dr. And welcome, Mr. Sharma. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. So, the president of BCIC, Mr. Parshuram, and I would like to now hand over the topic presentation by Mr. M.M. Sharma. Sir, I think now you are able to share on. Do you need an assistant? question, sir, from our side?
I think my screen is visible to all.
Yeah, it's visible. It is visible.
Thank you.
If so, you require our help, we will do it. Okay, okay, sir. You carry on.
Thank you very much. I will, if I have any problem, I'll talk to you on WhatsApp. Please keep your WhatsApp visible.
Sure. I'll.
So thank you, Dr. Om Prakash, for giving this opportunity to me to speak on a subject which is a passion with me, which is very much at my heart. This is the core of area of my practice. So before I let me first open the presentation's topic. Here is the topic we are going to discuss: introducing competition law, how it can help or destroy your business. So competition is something with which we are all familiar from the beginning, be it amongst our siblings for parental love and care, or for admission in good schools and colleges, for good jobs. However, today, what I'm going to speak about is competition among businesses in markets. No one likes competition. Everyone hates it. But it is inevitable. And one must realize its benefits not only for consumers and the national economy, but also for your business, since fair competition makes you and your employees more efficient. It is the fear of the unknown and the uncertainties of the markets that always keeps you on your toes and make you give your best performance. It increases your productivity, lowers your costs, and increases your profits due to optimal utilization of resources in the best possible manner. So India has been a late starter in understanding the importance of competition in markets and how this can propel growth exponentially. To make you realize the importance of what I just said, I'll take you through a bit of historical journey of how this law actually has evolved. So this concept of competition law is called antitrust in US. It originated in the US. In the last decades of the 19th century, around 1880s to 1890s, there were huge monopolies in the form of trusts, such as Standard Oil Company, Rockefeller Institutes, which were controlling huge conglomerates in key sectors such as steel, copper, oil, iron, sugar, tin, coal, even paper bags, envelopes, and rail, salts, etc. So these trusts were controlling the entire business in America, and they were not allowing the business to grow, except for a few houses. So the then US President Roosevelt thought of breaking these trusts, and an act called Sherman Act, 1890, was enacted. So Roosevelt used this act to break these monopolies into dozens separate smaller companies. For example, Standard Oil was broken into Exxon, and we had Exxon Mobil later on. Chevron came, and things like that. So the Americans were the first to understand the importance of introducing competition in business for the growth of the economy. The result was very good. So this made American economy very competitive, highly competitive. And because of this, America became the world's largest economic power. We all know. In fact, if you have to see the real competition, one has to go to the US department stores where you see inter-brand competition. You know, there are competition among shelves. So one brand of bread is competing with another brand of bread on the same shelf. So inter-brand competition is at the best in US, and the consumers have plenty of choices. Canada was the next country which followed this change almost simultaneously with the US. Japan. I would like to take a mention of Japan for a minute, because Japan, if you remember, was destroyed in the Second World War. Hiroshima and Nagasaki are the only twin cities which were bombarded with the atom bomb. By 1944-47, Japan was in check. I think there's a disturbance.
Request all of you to kindly mute.
Of introducing competition into the businesses in there, because they saw how the Americans were growing, Japan enacted an act called Japanese Fair Trade Act in 1947. You know the results. Japanese soon became the second economy of the world, and their brands became household names all over Europe and America, whether it is automobile, electronics, what have you. European Union followed the Japanese example, and in 1957 we had the Treaty of Rome. Australia soon followed with this Act of Trade Practices Act in 1965, and China followed this by opening its economy slowly in 1980s. But like rest of the third world, we took so long to understand the importance of introducing competition. So friend, you will remember that now we are living in a world of free market economy. It's a capitalistic model of free market economy because the old model of socialist ruled state controlled economies are gone with the demise of the Soviet Union in the 80s, thanks to Gorbachev. But nevertheless, India was still lucky to realize the importance of competition in 1991. You would realize that till 1990, we had followed the Nehruvian model of the mixed economy, which refers to the growth of public sector.
The Bluetooth device has connected us successfully.
The aim was to achieve the commonwealth for all. This was a general apathy to private sector enterprises. Results were apparent. So we had till that time a so-called Hindu rate of growth of less than 3%. License and permit raj was there, and government interfered in almost every sector of business. And you had to get permission from the government or the MRTP for even expanding your business. But in 1990, when the economic reform started with the opening of the market, leading to so-called free market economy and rule of market forces, we followed what is known as the LPG model, that is the liberalization, privatization, globalization. The results came slowly. Economists referred this period of 1960 to 1990 as the lost decades. In fact, in today's Times of India, I saw an article which mentions to these so-called lost decades. Four decades were lost. Now, thanks to the competition we have in many sectors today in India, we have so many options to choose from in all products and services, be it automobile, civil aviation, post and telegraph, insurance, banking, etc. Thanks to competition, slowly our consumers are becoming kings. In whichever sector, the competition has been working very well. Now, for example, our telecom tariffs are the lowest in the world. So slowly, the aam aadmi or the common man is actually getting benefited because of the access to the broadest range of services at affordable and competitive prices. But still, we have not yet reached the optimum level, and we have yet to open some of our sectors to competition. And in fact, now this government, this Modi government, is realizing the importance of opening to competition. You might remember that there was recently some talk on the TV about gradual opening of railways to certain sectors of the railways. So even Niti Aayog was recommended, according to me, they recommended to the government for opening some closed sector to the competition. But in my personal view, this ad hoc approach is not going to lead us longer. I mean, it's not going to make India achieve its optimum rate of growth. And we should actually consider going in a structural way. And that's why I recently wrote this article. I'll slip for a minute and I'll show you this article. You have to give me a minute because I think this wrong presentation was opened. So kindly give me a minute. I'm so sorry for this. So this is the article I wrote on 22nd August in 2020. It came in 22nd August of 2020. It came in Financial Express, making India competitive. I asked the government to adopt a national competition policy, which has shown the results in other parts of the world. So do we realize that slowly, because of these lost decades, due to the brain drain mainly in this period, our most brilliant IIT engineers have gone and settled in the US. And we have reduced from being innovators in the past to being service providers. We are good serving services. And finally, as mere consumers in the developed world. So the developed world sees India as a demand, as a market for more consumers, with the huge rural sector yet to be explored. So we have slowly started becoming used to serving the foreigners, and our unicorns are being slowly acquired by the Americans or Europeans. So Flipkart is no longer a Flipkart of India. It's a one-board control. controlled by the Walmart group. Even Alibaba has stakes in most of the unicorns, be it Paytm or what have you. So the point is that slowly India is becoming from an entrepreneur driven economy to a consumer driven economy, to a demand driven economy. I think you'll agree with this, not a very happy state of affairs. So why it is so? Because we have lost, we have failed to understand the importance of competition. As I said just now, that the Japanese, the Americans, the Europeans, the Australians, they all understood the importance of competition and opened the economy to real competition. But our industry are used to be protective. So we are used to the socialist time, you know, when industries get licenses, industries are protected. But that is not going to take us further. I'm going to share you something interesting. This is the joke. So antitrust, I explained it to you. So this is the antitrust joke. So these three CEOs met in a jail in America, because in America, antitrust violation is a criminal offense. And they started talking to each other. So when one of them said, when the prices went up, the judges said it was too high. And when the prices went down, the other one CEO said, I was accused of being too low of predatory price. And the third one said, because my price was same as my competitors, so I was accused of cartels. So whichever way your prices go, you can be accused of antitrust. So this is the joke, which is quite commonly used in the antitrust parlance. So India has to understand that antitrust has a very long reach. We have to understand that antitrust can catch you either way, because on price, whichever way you, either you're high or low or you're same, the law is there to catch with you. So now let me begin my presentation, and this is the scheme of my presentation. To introduce the competition law and how the market behaves, and then I'll give the overview of the Competition Act and talk about cartels and anti-competitive activities. So this is how we will. Let us begin now. So what is competition law? A competition law actually is essentially concerned the study of markets. The objective of the competition law is to ensure that the competition between suppliers in any market benefits consumers. Day-to-day level, applying competition law involves identifying markets, assessing whether competition is working well in those markets, and how firms' actions affect competition and consumers. But these are essentially economic issues. Economics is an essential tool to assess effects of competitiveness in markets. It is therefore imperative for all lawyers in India who want to practice in this law to study economics and to develop a clear understanding of economic issues, such as determination of correct relevant market, determination of entry barriers, etc. It has been actually said by a US judge, Justice Brandeis, and I quote, "A lawyer who has not studied economics is very apt to become a public enemy." Unquote. Understanding demand and supply hold the keys. For example, what do we understand by market? Can we say car is a market? Well, a common man will say yes, why not? But I'll say no. Car has many segments. There are segments of this market. So there's A segment. So a person who buys Maruti will not look for in the luxury segment. The segments of who decides this market? The decision is made by the consumer, the pocket of the consumer, what the consumer wants to buy. So what makes a product is the market, the demand for the market. It's obviously the demand. But how this demand for a particular product is determined? I gave you an example of car. You can take examples of anything else. For example, are tea and coffee the same market? May or may not. So there are products which are complementary, there are products which are supplementary, and there are products which are substitutable. So substitutability of products is determined by doing a test on increasing of prices, because there are economic tools, SSNIP tests and all. I will not go to that. So the demand basically of a product comes out from the consumer's choice, irrespective of the fact that what is the supplier's choice or what the supplier wants to give. So basically, then to create demand, you have to advertise, you have to do all kinds of things. So in this particular slide, I'm just taking you through what is the objective. The objective is to make markets competitive, to avoid market power, to avoid abuse of dominance, and to protect fair competition in the market, which is in the interest of both the suppliers as well as the consumers. And importantly, to have a level playing field in the market for all players. So the competition law basically aims to prevent exercise of market power or abuse of dominant position, which is inherent in any business. So the moment you grow to a particular size, the moment you have a large market share, you start capturing the market. Why not? Like to capture the market is inherent in any business. So competition law is that tool which will check you to that and to curb the behavior of large firms to, you know, either avoid small firm coming inside, either block the entry of new firms or to block the expansion of existing firms. So as you say, a small fish is vulnerable. So big fish is trying to eat a small fish. It's like what happens in the competitive economy also. We know corporate wars, we all know about it. So this is the law which checks that. This law which takes care that the small fish is not eaten by the big fish all the time. So why do we need competition in the market? I'm just recapitulating what I just said. To improve efficiency of the markets, wider choice to consumers, optimal utilization of resources, and maximize welfare. Mind you, it's not welfare of the consumers, it's the welfare of the suppliers as well. Because if your productivity increases, if your efficiency increases, your prices will come down, your sale will be more, and if your sale is more, you will have more profits. If your marginal costs come down, then also you'll have more profits. So it's both sides winning actually. So consumers also win because of better quality, cheaper prices, and supplier also win. So it's a total welfare concept. In fact, in the antitrust economy, it's called allocative efficiencies. And it's beneficial to all. So it generates economic growth, productivity increases. So that's why I said it is linked to economic growth directly. It exponentially increases, and it has been shown. The examples I gave in the beginning of US, Japan, and all those developed world. The developed world today are here because they had understood the importance of competition. We in India have still to understand. I mean, we are just trying to grapple with what is this competition law? Because like an elephant, you know, like an elephant and four blind men. You might have heard the story of four or five blind men trying to understand how an elephant looks like. So each one of goes to whichever part of the elephant he says it's like that. So I want to open those blindfold people to understand what competition is. Huge. It's a panacea, according to me, for all the economic ills which are facing the country. So what is unfair competition, for example? So unfair competition, let us see, we saw the benefits of competition. What is unfair competition? So either it is collusive price fixing, cartels, or deliberate reduction in output. So you have capacity, because you want to create a situation of scarcity so that demand is created. And then you will increase the price, the demand increases. Then you have creation of barriers to enter. You will not allow the others to enter the field. As I said, the large firms have this tendency. Allocation of market, you allocate market amongst yourself. So we have the cement cartel, we divided India into four parts. North India go to this particular company, South India go to this particular company, East and West. So I will not name the companies, but this was proved, this was there. And the cement cartel was first proposed by the CCI. And then there are tie-in sales, exclusive supply. So these are all examples which I'll take you through later on as I proceed with the lecture. So these are examples of unfair competition. And in this background, now we have the Competition Act. So this came the Competition Act, as I said. And these are the features of the Competition Act. Please understand. So it's mandated to eliminate practices having appreciable adverse effect on competition. It's a fair market regulator. Competition Commission of India, its mandate applies across all the market, all the sectors of economy, and it is now in sync with the modern competition laws of all developed economies, and has these objectives I just tried to bring out: promote and sustain competition, protect interests of consumers, ensure freedom of trade carried out by the participants of India. This is what Competition Commission is. And this is the Competition Act. The Modern Competition Act has got four broad areas. So prohibits anti-competitive agreements, prohibits abuse of dominant position, provides for regulation of combinations, and enjoins competition advocacy. So competition is, mind you, see the first two bullets. So it prohibits anti-competitive agreement, including cartels. It prohibits abuse of dominant position, but it does not prohibit what is known as combination. From combination, I mean mergers and acquisitions. Why? Because mergers and acquisitions are a sign of the economy. They are required. And of course, competition advocacy is required for the competition spread the message of good competition, fair competition amongst all. So CCI basically is an off-market regulator. It is not an in-market regulator like the other sector regulator, for example, TRAI or IRDA. The sector regulators which are operating in the market. So they regulate day-to-day behavior of the firms. But CCI is not into that. CCI will only come into force when you have a problem with the competitor. When the competitive situation of a market or sector is disturbed, then CCI is there. So these sections, please take note, 3, 4, 5 and 6 and section 49 is about advocacy. Section 3 is about anti-competitive agreement. Section 4 is abuse of dominant position. Section 5 and 6 is mergers. And 49 is advocacy. So these are the broad categories of agreements and conduct which are prohibited under the competition law. And I'm just showing you this bullet because anti-competitive agreements, abuse of dominant position and merger regulations are inside. This is already explained, and then let's come to anti-competitive. Friends, agreement, what we understand by agreements? Agreements in competition are very wide. They're very widely understood. Agreements need not be in writing. Agreement need not be even legally binding. So an understanding is covered. Any oral understanding between the participants of markets are covered as an agreement. But mind you, it's not every agreement which is covered. It's agreement in respect of production, supply, distribution, storage, or acquisition of control of goods or provision of services. And such agreements, when they have what is known as appreciable adverse effect on competition, I put it as a small AAEC is the term which we use, appreciable adverse effect on competition. So if these agreements lead to having what is known as AAEC, then they are prohibited and they are void. So any agreement which causes or likely to cause an AAEC is void. That is section 3.1 clause. And there are two kinds of anti-competitive agreements. That means agreements are divided into two parts or two categories, you can say, so to say. So the first is the horizontal agreement. That means agreement between direct competitors, and they include cartels. These agreements, which actually have the direct object of destroying competition, are known as horizontal anti-competitive agreement, and they are presumed to have an appreciable adverse effect if they result into fixing prices, limiting markets, or allocating customers or territories, or even bid rigging. So these are the hardcore antitrust provisions or cartels. How are cartels defined? Cartels are defined as an SO, and I will quote the section 2C of the Act. Cartel includes an association of producers, sellers, distributors, traders or service providers who by agreement among themselves limit, control or attempt to control the production, distribution, sale or price of or trade of goods, trade in goods or provision services. Might be very interesting. So there are four varieties of cartel broadly speaking, either price fixing cartels, market sharing cartels, output restricting cartels or bid rigging. In India, we have so far had maximum case of bid rigging because public procurement in India costs about 30% of the GDP. So many people bid for these public services, public sector, trying to the public sector, including railways and everybody, and we have had maximum cases of cartels on bid rigging. So if you see, if you notice the definition which I just said, so even an attempt to cartelize is also punishable. I'll give you a very interesting example. Suppose you are a bidder in a particular tender, and you try to cartelize with other participants, but you don't get that bid. You're not successful. You don't get the order. And suppose it is disclosed that you were actually cartelizing, you were coordinating. You can't go to CCI and say, look, I haven't got the order, so why do you punish me? That's where the law catches low. Even if you attempt to coordinate with your competitors to fix prices, it is equally a violation. So it doesn't matter whether you get the order, but it doesn't matter whether actually a cartel takes place or not. An attempt to cartelize is equally bad, it's equally pernicious. So the other, of course, agreements are limiting fixing prices, limiting allocating agreement, and are all there. Cartels are, as I said, the most pernicious of this. And how to prove a cartel? I take for a minute. So cartels are not proved by direct evidence. There are circumstantial evidences. There are economic evidences. There are evidence of conduct, for example. So whether the market is highly oligopolistic, whether it's highly concentrated, things like that have to be seen. Whether there are high profits of the firms, there are stable market shares, the history of competition law violations. And then the structural evidence also is there, low concentration, etc. And that is what is called as Economic evidence is the kind of communicative evidence, whether there is a communication between the parties or the call detail records are also seen. You will not have the recording of the call, but actually there are, you are talking to your competitors during the particular time of a tender. It is considered as a circumstantial evidence that you were in touch with them. So the CCI has been following the doctrine of College of Preponderance of Probability, which on which I highly criticize them in my article. So what is known as conscious parallelism plus. So there is, if there is a structural evidence, if there is a circumstantial evidence, there is a plus factor. What are those plus factors? For example, the existence of trade unions, or sorry, trade associations are there. So if you are in a trade association where you meet regularly, then the CCI might presume that your trade association is felicitating a cartelite. So that they are issues which are very, very serious. This whole plethora of jurisprudence over the subject, but because of the paucity of time, I can't go into that. So let us see what is vertical agreement. So vertical agreements are essentially agreement between manufacturers and their dealers. And they are most important because they are, the vertical agreement actually come in touch with the consumer directly. So when we talk of vertical agreement, whether in the online or offline sales, let's speak about three broad categories. So three broad categories are either dealing restrictions, there is exclusive supply, exclusive distribution agreements, pricing restrictions, that is including maximum price or minimum price, maintenance like MRP, dual pricing, etc., rebates, discounts, or non-pricing restrictions such as tying in, bundling, refusal to deal. The substantial law of competition analysis and vertical restraint of vertical restraints of both price related or non-price related is the same. That is whether these restrictions have the possibility of causing appreciable adverse effect on competition or not. So such restraints are harmful only when the parties involved have significant market power or in dominant position, and when they possess ability to foreclose the market. So it's only when either of the players, either the dealer is strong or the supplier is strong, either they, any of them is in a dominant position or they are in a position of strong market power where they can foreclose the market for others to enter, then only the vertical agreements have what is called as appreciable adverse effect. Otherwise, generally they are benign, because vertical agreements at the end of the day are very, very pro-competitive as well. They remove the, you know, free riding, for example, free riding kind of situations, and they also bring in efficiency into the system. So generally they are pro-competitive, but they are, that's why they are assessed under rule of reason. So section 3.3, which I said of horizontal agreements, have a presumption, like a per se violation of presumed to have an appreciable adverse effect. So the commission has to only prove an agreement. So if there is an agreement between competitor, that is the end of the day. You don't have to go, they don't have to prove that this will cause effect on competition. It is presumed by the law that it will cause. So there's a presumption. But in case of vertical agreement, it is not the case. In vertical agreement, the presumption is of pro-competitiveness. But unless there are these factors, which I said, whether they are large market share, dominant, etc., so they are given in section 19.3. So vertical agreements are generally analyzed by rule of reason. Another thing I give, because the theory of harm of possibility of foreclosure comes, vertical agreements only when there is a, what is the state of inter-brand competition itself. If the inter-brand competition in the markets is strong, irrespective of whether the intra-brand competition is weak, it may not have the foreclosure effect. But when both intra-brand brand and inter-brand competition are vigorous, for example, and there is a less, even a lesser danger of a vertical restraint being having any appreciable adverse effect. However, where an inter-brand competition is weak, means where there are lesser suppliers in the market, this vertical restraint, if it is imposed, can potentially lead to closure or softening of price competition. So, and under the, of course, Indian competition, vertical restraint can either be examined under section 4, that is abuse of dominance, or under section 3.4, under the rule of reason analysis. We can take question of vertical restraint because we recently did a webinar on 28th of August on price restrictions, resale price maintenance. So let us see the important cases of cartel. Let us see the important cases of, yes, sir.
Omprakash here, before going into the next few other slides,
I'll just show these cases, then we go to the next topic. So this is, just have a look at the, just give me a minute, sir, to complete this topic. These are the four important cases which I've highlighted of cartels. So we have the cement cartel, we have the LPG cartel. Kindly see the penalties, huge penalty in cement, 6,000 crore penalties were imposed. LPG cartel was 65, I was a part of this case. PSU General Insurance Cartel, even PSU insurance companies have been penalized by the government. So let me, I forgot to mention, Competition Commission of India is the only regulator which can punish even government companies. It can even punish the government department. I have seen the joint secretary of Ministry of Finance being cast to come before the Competition Commission of India and asked to explain certain policies. It's a very strong regulator. It's something like an election commission. If it is independent, it's mostly independent. And of course, the alphabet cartels also, Food Corporation of India, there are many other cartels. In fact, I just highlighted these four. So before I proceed to the next, I think Dr. Prakash has something to say. Yes, sir.
Yeah, we'll keep the session going on, but in between, I will also shoot some questions which have come so that it, you know,
people can have that way. Fine, tell me. Yeah.
Mr. N. Ravichandra has shooted a question. He's asking about this Competition Act has been preceded by MRTP Act. So can you just some background of what he's asking?
Sure. So as I said at the beginning, MRTP Act was a law of the pre-liberalized economy. It was a socialist. Under the socialist model of economy, the MRTP Act was there. Under the MRTP Act, you had to take permission to expand your businesses. So this MRTP Act of 1969, in fact, we copied this act of the UK, which also has a Monopoly Trade Practices Act. So Indian Act was more or less a copy of the English Act, because even in England, at that time, the competition law had not fully come in, by the way. I'm talking of 60s. So this MRTP Act actually is not, this Competition Act is not a new MRTP Act. I mean, I forgot because of the shortage of time, I didn't give you the background, because the government appointed a Raghavan committee, high powered committee was set up, and we gave commitment into the WTO that we'll modernize our competition law in sync with the modern competition laws of the Europe and America, so that their companies can come into India and do the FDI. So this Competition Act is totally a new concept. It's American law. It's completely different. It's not MRTP Act at all. So MRTP Act is now a thing of past. It was repealed when competition law came into force. I'm going to take you that, because in the next slide I'm going to tell when this law came. The law came in 2009. By the way, the Act was amended, and the Act was enacted in 2002. But because of a challenge in the Supreme Court, by vested interest, I will say, the law could not be enforced except for competition advocacy. So the enforcement started only 20th May 2009. I was in CJA at that time when the law was not enforced. So we actually amended the Act in 2007. Yes, sir. Any other question?
Yeah, there is another observation from Mr. P.G. Subramanian. With Reliance acquiring so many consumer companies, including the deal to acquire Future Retail, will I not infringe competition law? He is questioning about the fairness of the law. Where is the fairness is what he is questioning. It's an observation. Any comments on that?
No. I take that observation with a pinch of salt. Fairness has to be brought in, and the law is there for that purpose only. But all such deals which are beyond a certain threshold are examined by the CCI. You might have seen Bayer Monsanto. You might have seen Holcim Lafarge. All big ticket mergers are examined by the Competition Commission. Nothing can move on. So, but we have deliberately, because of the business lobby being strong, and since I'm also associated with those to some extent in the chambers of commerce like CII, FICCI and ASSOCHAM, etc., I know how the lobbies work. So they deliberately did not allow the commission to bring down lower thresholds. Our thresholds are highest in the world. That's why small ticket mergers go off the radar. But we have a mandatory filing regime, so you have to go and file and take a permission before proceeding further. It includes even IBC filing, by the way. So if you are taking a distressed asset under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, and if that acquisition amounts to a combination under the Act, so under Section 31(4) of the IBC, as after amendment, you have your resolution plan has to be in compliance with the competition law. You have to go to the CCI and take approval first before the resolution professional can admit that resolution plan. So all that is taken care of by the law now.
Okay, sir. And whether dealership arrangement having territorial restrictions considered as anti-competitive agreements?
Say that again, sir. I couldn't hear. Whether
dealership arrangement having territory restrictions, is it anti-competitive agreements? Some people restrict
the territory. Yeah, yeah, very good. Because I ran through very fast when I was telling you about the political agreements.
Mr. Mahesh Kumar.
Yeah. So thank you, sir, for this question. So exclusive, this call is a part of exclusivity. Exclusivity per se is not bad. Exclusivity in terms of geographical areas is also very much prevalent in the market. So not every exclusive dealership which bounds you to certain geographies is anti-competitive. It's not that simple. It is anti-competitive only when you are not allowed to take orders from other areas which are passive in nature. So there is an active supply and there is a passive supply. So active supply, the company can certainly, for the sake of its, because a company is also free to distribute its product the way it wants. It may have a number of dealers in, say, in particular city in Chennai. It may try to restrict the dealership so to only 4 dealers. So if it has to have 4 dealers, it will definitely demarket the areas. Nothing wrong in it. But if it stops the dealer in market A, in area A, to refuse to respond to the direct queries which come from area B, then it will be anti-competitive. So there's something called active selling. You cannot actively go and sell beyond your area. But if orders come to you directly, for example, through internet, suppose you're also online. So online, there's nothing like, online is like a passive selling. Anybody can reach you. You can't refuse. So not every geographical territory is anti-competitive, sir. There are so many questions we can, and it depends on the market power, as I said, whether the distribution has the ability to foreclose market, whether the supplier has a strong market position. If it's a dominant player, yes, it may have an effect on competition. So there are various subjective criteria, various factors which have to be seen. But generally speaking, it is not anti-competitive. Sir, can I proceed to abuse of dominance?
Yeah, you can proceed. There are a couple of questions. If you can, take it for 10 minutes, then later on.
Maybe we can take, sir, that after I'm done with this, because we have to restrict the timing also. It's quarter to 5 already, sir.
Sure. Please carry on.
So, abuse of dominance. Let me come to section 4. So, please see this slide. It's not dominance which is bad, but it's abuse which is profited. So, unlike the MRTP Act, where we had this, dominant was also a subject matter of regulation. It is not so the case. So you can be as big as Reliance. You can become Reliance. Nobody stops you. But you cannot abuse it. You cannot abuse your dominance. I think some of you would remember the fight between Airtel, Bharti Airtel, Vodafone, and Jio. I think most of you would remember. So what was the case? Most people ask me, why did CCI not penalize Reliance? They are the largest. I asked. I said, as a layman, you can say whatever, say, but as a competition lawyer, I will not agree with you. Because Jio, when it introduced these, cheap phones, 500 rupees phone, it was entering the market. It was entering the new market. It was not dominant. So predatory pricing can be clubbed only with a dominant player. Unless you are dominant, you can't be doing predatory pricing. So for a new entrant to give you the cheaper, it's entering price. And at that time, the market shares of Airtel and Vodafone were slightly higher than that of Jio. This case went to the CCI. So, mind you, the first bullet is what is abuse. These abuses are actually 4 or 5 abuses which are listed out here. Unfair or discriminatory pricing, including predatory pricing. Limiting production or technical development, denial of market access, conclusion of contract subject to supply of supplemental obligations, use of dominant position in one market to enter into another market. So, except for these 5 prohibited conducts, and dominance here in India is like per se violation. I mean, it's very, very well defined that when you can be accused of being abusive in your dominant position, only when you indulge in either of these 5 conducts. Let me give you a little bit of theory of dominant position. So what is dominant position? They are defined under the Act, but I'll give you my own understanding of this. The dominant position is the ability of a firm, please listen very carefully, to sustain prices profitably above competitive levels, or to restrict output or quality below competitive levels. If you are so strong that you don't care, and you can reduce your prices, you can increase the prices profitably, because you know that everybody will come to you. Normally, when the prices increase, the consumer go to the cheaper version, right? So unless you are a monopoly, you can't do it. If you are a monopoly, there's no choice with the consumer. Even if you increase price, he has to come to you. And then that depends on the structure of the market. There are markets which are inelastic. For example, the market for pharmaceutical companies or petrol. Whatever is the product, what is the price, you have to go for buy petrol. You can't help it, right? So depends on the structure of the market, the condition of the market. So how Section 4 defines the dominance is, it's a very subjective definition, by the way. Position of strength enjoyed by enterprise in the relevant market, which enables it to operate independent of competition in the relevant market or affect its competitors or consumers or even the relevant market to fail. Imagine, when you're so large that you don't care what your competitors will think, you can behave the way you want. You are like the DLF in North India. So, and the DLF case is famous. So dominant position, you might notice from this definition, is not based on market shares alone. Though market shares are an essential factor considered by the commission while considering whether a player is dominant or not, but they are not the only factor. And this is by the way, the main difference between the Indian law and the European competition. In the European competition law, market shares provide a very, very clear-cut determinant factor to consider whether they're dominant or not. And there's a reason why we have not adopted the European model, because you see, in a free market economy, the market shares of companies go. They can go. Where is Nokia now? Where is Kodak? There were large companies, they're gone. Because if the entry is free, then large market share may not last longer. So that is competition. So basically, competition economists assess dominance in terms of A, level of concentration of the market, that is the number of players in the market. B, determination of potential competition in the market by assessing the barriers to the entry or exit. And concentration in the market is determined in terms of course, market share. Whereas the entry barriers, there are entry barriers unless there are regulatory or legal barriers can be assessed based on the firm's large firm in the market. So in European Union, for example, 40% of market share is considered as dominant, 40% or above. But in the US, there's no such market share cap. Section 2 of the Sherman Act, for example, does not prohibit monopoly power, but it prohibits the conduct that impairs competition. So in India, we have chosen to go more like the American law, and we have chosen to prohibit the conduct more, as you see from the bullets. So basically, the point is, to determine relevant determine dominance in a market, you have to first determine the relevant market. And as I said, relevant market is determined on the basis of substitutability of the product. And there are three parameters: price, characteristics, and end use. So on these three parameters, the firms compete: price, characteristics, and end use. So product, you have to determine the relevant product market. You have also determined the relevant geographic market. So in the geographic area where this product is available also has to be seen, and that's how you have to calculate the dominance of the firm and what is the market share in that particular product, keeping in mind the possibility of substitution, etc. So predatory pricing is also defined in the law with predatory pricing below, selling below average variable cost, and the average variable cost is defined by regulations by the commission. We have had cases on predatory pricing, and the next bullet will show you those cases. So these are the important cases of abuse of dominance. And Samshir Singh Kataria being the foremost, if you may have heard of the spare part case, car spare part case, I can take questions. Because I'm advising the, I should not be saying automobile markets extensively. Hyundai case we have got. Hyundai was a classic case of resale price maintenance. The discounts were being controlled. The company had engaged into what is known as mystery shopping. So if a dealer, you know, wanted to give more discount to a customer on the car, and if it is revealed to the company, his dealership is terminated. You know, this was the situation. Some dealers went to the CCI and Hyundai was penalized because they were having mystery shopping agencies. They were controlling the discount. Discount control mechanisms were in force. So, and the T-Series case, of course, we were also involved in this case. And the BCCI case, penalty of 52 crores. BCCI case is interesting. BCCI was considered as an enterprise, though it's a self-regulated body. Because BCCI gave the contract for IPL for 10 years to Sony TV. 10 years was considered a long period. So if you create exclusivity for a longer period, longer than 5 years, then it is anti-competitive. CCI penalized it for this huge penalty. There's an ITPO case in Pragati Maidan in Delhi. The National Stock Exchange, in which I was involved, I was the counsel for NSE. This is a case of predatory price. And very interesting, I'll take a minute on this. National Stock Exchange in 2008 started currency derivative segment. And for about 7 or 8 months, it was the only player in the market. What is currency derivative? The dollar rupee fluctuation. So the traders, the brokers play on that. So you trade that dollar rupee fluctuation. Currency derivatives is a very niche segment of the stock exchange market. After 8 months or so, MCX-SX was made. The multi-commodity exchange entered into this stock exchange business. It was granted the license by the SEBI and the Finance Ministry. And it also started this currency derivative segment. Now, what happened was that the NSE was giving this currency derivative segment to its existing brokers for free. They were not charging any transaction fee. So if you are a broker registered with NSE over equity market or over debt or other F&O, etc., you will get the currency derivative for a free, right? Now, MCX SX said, it went to the Competition Commission and said that we cannot, because we are a new player, we don't have so much bandwidth, we're not present in the other segments of the stock exchange. So we are being killed because we cannot afford to give this, this product to our brokers on free, because there's nothing can be less than zero. So they say NSE being hugely dominant in the market is actually doing predatory price. It's a very interesting case. So since we were defending NSE, we tried to argue over the commission that, well, the market is not stock exchange. Stock exchange market is not the relevant market. That was the whole issue on which we won that case, because it was found that the stock exchange was not the market. The products in stock exchange had different characteristics. So equity had a different characteristic, debt had a different characteristic, F&O had a different characteristic, things like that. And currency derivative is certainly different than equity. So if a broker who is operating in currency derivative segment where day-to-day fluctuations are seen will not be interested in investing in the equity segment, because that is long-term investment, or in the debt segment for that matter. So since the product characteristic, all the products were different, the CCI actually agreed with us, yes, that currency derivative is a unique product and sell in a separate market. So having said that, the CCI agreed with us that we were not dominant in that particular market. But why we lost? Now you will ask me, but still you have been imposed penalty of 55 crore. Why we lost was because the CCI said, all right, you are not dominant currency derivative segment, you are only two players and you are equally competing, but you are dominant in the market for equity. You're dominant in the market for F&O and debt, where you are having 95% market share. Please remember, NSE is the fourth largest exchange in India. It has 95% market share in all these segments. And they say you're leveraging your dominance in one market to protect your dominance in the other market. So please see section 4E. That is, you are to use your dominance in one market to enter or protect your dominance in the other market. So leveraging your dominance was the allegation which was proved against us, because at that time NSE was not doing what we call a segmental reporting. There was a consolidated balance sheet. All the profit used to come in one balance sheet, and they were not having separate balance sheets for separate products of the stock exchange. So later on they did. So that is a very typical case of predatory pricing I just thought of sharing with you. And of course, the last case, the DLF case, in which very, very interesting case, still going into the Supreme Court. DLF was a hugely dominant player in Gurgaon. Gurgaon is made by DLF only. So at that time when this case went, these allottees of Belair Association went to CCI and said that DLF is having what is called as unfair conditions in the allotment buyer agreement, like all other builders. So if you delay in the pay, and of course DLF delayed in handing over the position of Blair apartment, which is a very costly apartment. Each apartment was about 4 to 5 crores at that time. So they say you've delayed about giving the apartments and you are charging us penalty at the rate of 24% if you delay in giving the EMIs. Whereas the builder is delaying the delivery of the houses, there is only 5 rupees per square feet paisa penalty. And all agreements, all the conditions were one-sided, unfair against the consumer. CCI started investigating DLF. DLF said, well, why are you only investigating me? Such conditions are prevalent all over India. So all other builders, whether it's Parasnag, Unitech, even Shobha, wherever you talk, I will not name Shobha because I don't know whether Shobha had that condition or not. But of course, in North India, most the builders had those unfair conditions. So CCI said, fine, let us examine the others also. So would you believe me? CCI, on the basis of the statement of DLF, started investigating all other real estate dealers. All other real estate players were investigated by the commission. We were involved for 2-3 builders at that time. So the point I'm trying to make is that abuse of dominant position was found to be there, though it was qua consumer. Now the moot issue of the Supreme Court is whether an agreement between a consumer and a builder can be seen under the Competition Act, or it is a consumer case. So the DLF's main ground was it is a consumer case, whereas the CCI said, no, you are putting unfair condition in sale of product. A house is a product. And section 421 says unfair. So unfair is unfair. So if there are conditions which are one-sided, they're unfair. That is the whole case, a moot question of how the Supreme Court decides. So then I come to the regulation of combinations, that is mergers and acquisitions. So as I said, combinations are what? Mergers and acquisitions, amalgamations, etc. But they are not prohibited, but only regulated. This is because that corporate restructuring frequently involves intra-group and intra-group mergers and acquisitions, amalgamations, which are a sign of growing economy. It is only those mergers which are either direct between direct competitors or horizontal mergers or vertical mergers between suppliers, strong suppliers and strong dealers, which can create a single firm dominance kind of a situation or can produce effects similar to the appreciable adverse effect of competition, which are required to be scrutinized by the commission. Because before they are allowed to proceed, because if it is not done, so it's called an ex-ante regulation. What I showed in the beginning was that CCI is mostly exposed. So as far as abuse of dominance is concerned, is exposed. Anti-competitive agreement is concerned, it is exposed. But so far as regulation of mergers is concerned, it is ex-ante. It has to be. Because if you allow mergers to happen and then you start scrutinizing, it's like unscrambling an omelette. They've already merged. You can't unscramble an omelette. So mergers are required to be scrutinized before they proceed. And the theory of firm is called unilateral effects. So whether the merged entities will become so large that they can increase prices of a competitor. So the ability of merged entities to increase prices is the only theory of firm which the commission looks at from the economic point of view. So it's called unilateral effects or coordinated effects also. There are unilateral effects is the main theory of firm. That is possibility of the merged entity to monopolize the market or to raise price above competitive levels. And how does CCI takes care of that? CCI takes care of that by directing the companies to divest their overlapping businesses. So wherever there is an overlap, that particular portion will be asked to be divested to third parties. So they will have to bring out customers who will purchase them, so the competition is maintained in those portions. That is how the CCI balances the competition in those areas. And there are two kinds of filings, by the way, Form 1 or Form 2. We have a mandatory regime, as I said, the Competition Commission is supposed to decide within 210 days, otherwise it's deemed to be approved. And CCI can also take suo motu action. Suppose you forget to file into CCI, this is called gun jumping. So substantial gun jumping and procedural gun jumping. But now they have liberalized the gun jumping. So then these are the revised threshold. Please see, we have the highest thresholds in the world. So 2,000 crore, 6,000 crore US dollar, 1 billion now that you see. And also please see these two exemptions which are granted by the government. And they are valid only till 2021. I can take questions. One is the de minimis exemption. So if you are taking a company or a unit whose asset is less than 350 crores or turnover is less than 1,000 crore, you need not notify. You may have large thresholds. You may be a 600, 8,000 crore company, it doesn't matter. But if you're acquiring a smaller company, then you don't have to go to CCI. You got de minimis. And this exemption is valid only till 2021, March. Similarly, definition of group. So if you are a group which is having less than 50% stakes in the other company, then you are not a group. Then you don't have to notify, you won't be considered as a group. And these are the famous cases of merger which I just thought of. So recently we had the Linde Praxair case and the Bayer Monsanto, even I wrote an article on this. And PVR's acquisition of DLF. So DLF acquired, PVR Cinema acquired DLF's utilities, Holcim Lafarge, Sun Pharma Renvexi. So we were involved in 2-3 of these mergers. And I was also, I would like to name very interestingly, recent case of which I was involved, Patanjali's taking over Ruchi Soya. So Patanjali acquired Ruchi Soya business, and this was a resolution plan. And of course, we have got them the approval from CCI about that. So with this, I'll stop. There are questions I'll be ready to take, or maybe Dr. Prakash, I'll leave it to you. So let us see. Now, our topic is how it can destroy your business. Let us come to that part. So please see the substantial powers that the commission has. Cease and desist orders, penalties up to 10% of the average turnover. It's huge. In case of cartels, penalty up to 3 times of each year of continuation of cartels. I tell you, I have defended the maximum number of cartels in this country. We have got 9 cartels. People do not know that they are in a cartel. And the result is they end up losing their businesses. I've seen people crying, directors of the company, that we are gone because we can't afford. So the MSMEs, the small companies, not medium, even not 50 crores, micro enterprises. I cannot disclose because it's a sensitive subject. I'm helping so many small, small companies across India who have no understanding that they were exchanging, you know, messages on WhatsApp. And when the down raid happens, I tell you, the CCI has become very proactive. They even do down raid. I'll just show to come to that later. But see the level of penalty they have got. They can declare the agreement as void. They can even modify the agreement. No other regulator in this country, even the courts cannot modify an agreement. Court cannot declare your agreement as void unless it is against the law. Unless it violates section 28 of the contract act, it is against the fundamental law or the principles of public policy, etc. Even courts can't declare an agreement as void. First, the CCI can do it. It can modify the agreement. And it has the extraordinary power of even dividing enterprise. As I said at the beginning of the Microsoft case, you know, Microsoft in 1995 was divided into three parts on the complaint of Google by FTC in America. Why? Because Microsoft was hugely dominant in operating software. Windows was the only OS everybody was working on. Still people are working on it. But at that time, it had bundled that operating software with Internet Explorer and Windows Media Player. If you remember that in the late 1990s, Internet Explorer was the only search engine which we used to have on the computer. Where was Google? Where was Yahoo? Because they were not allowed compatibility with the operating software of Windows. So Google went to the FTC in America and said, that way we'll never be able to come into the business because products are different. And operating software is a different product. Internet Explorer or the search engine is a different product. And Media Player is a different product. So on that, the inquiry went on for 5 years, 4 or 5 years before the FTC. And finally, the FTC told America, Microsoft to divide its business into three parts. The same power the Competition Commission of India has, please note, the last bullet, that in case of a dominant enterprise, it can order division of the enterprise. Right. I gave you the example of NSE. NSE almost ended up losing such a huge amount, 55 crores, because you were not doing segmental reporting. You can be accused of leveraging your dominance in one market to protect the position in the other market. The typical case of NSE. So, this is how, that's what I said, that it can even destroy your business if you're not careful. If you don't understand competition law, if you have no understanding, which I'm trying to bring a little bit, you can be destroyed. Kindly see the other consequences. And these are also no less. So private damages, by the way, with this competition law, we have the private litigation in India. Private damages, you know, class action cases can come to India. So if you are a victim of a cartel, for example, not only the companies will be penalized by the CCI with huge turnover, etc., the victims can sue those companies who were in cartel for the damage they have suffered. In America, there are billions of dollars of claim. There they call triple damages. We don't have triple damage yet. But consider the case of abuse of dominance, which I've noted here also. If you are a victim of abuse of dominance, like in the Bel Air case, well, let me tell you very interesting. While the appeal of DLF is pending in the Supreme Court, they have been made to deposit 670 crores already into the Supreme Court registry. Supreme Court said, unless you deposit this money, we're not going to entertain your appeal. So 100 crore per month, and they were made to deposit this amount in the Treasury, in the registry. But the people who are the victims are waiting in wings that once they finally lose this case in Supreme Court, they are ready with their compensation claims. Each person is ready with a claim of 2 crore, 3 crore, etc. Imagine DLF will be burdened with a combined class action suit of about 1200 crores. You don't know how much before the NCLT. So apart from what I said, the penalty with the CCI, very strong, they can also be burdened with class action suit by the victims. And then, of course, agreement with your company may be declared void. Penalties on individuals are also important. Mind it. So a chairman, managing director, your KMPs of your companies or your firms are equally vulnerable. Apart from the penalties on the company or the firm, your individuals of your company who are responsible for the anti-competitive conduct can also be penalized. And by the way, CCI has got a standard practice. So they will, at the end of the inquiry, ask for the turnover of the companies for the last 3 years. They will also ask the balance sheet of the income tax returns of the managing director, the chairman, for the last 3 years. So it is simultaneously done. And if you are reading your newspaper carefully, there's a company called Cadila, so pharmaceutical. Cadila had challenged this into the High Court. They said, how can you decide? How can you ask my chairman's balance income tax return because you've not yet held that I'm in anti-competitive conduct? During inquiry proceeding, you can't ask. They went and filed a writ petition. The High Court dismissed the writ petition. They said it's a normal way. So the point is, the law is so clear now, the jurisprudence is already settled. And then, of course, significant legal and opportunity costs. You know, by the way, we competition lawyer charge a little more than a normal lawyer. So our charges are quite expensive. The competition litigation is not that easy. Then it's reputational damage. Do you remember the case of Maruti? If you remember, this was in the news recently. Recently, like the Hyundai case, on the complaint of a dealer from Goa, CCI is investigating the Maruti Suzuki company. Same complaint. Same exclusive supply agreements, same discount control mechanism, same mystery shopping agencies, allegations. They are all allegations. I'm not saying they're proof. But the moment this news came into the newspaper, from the next day, the market share of Maruti Suzuki nosedived by 10%. So reputational damage is huge. Then blacklisting, that's also important. So if your company or your firm is found to be involved in a bid rigging cartel, mind you, the public sector enterprise is going to block you for at least 5 years. You will blacklist it. So you lose opportunity cost also. And of course, there's a fine. If an individual, by the way, director is fined with more than 1,000 rupees under the Companies Act, he cannot be eligible to be re-elected as a director for the company. Full-time director, he cannot be. The last one. So for these issues, I wrote this article, Door CCI at Your Own Peril. This came in 2018. It's in Business Standard, and this was, of course, in a different context of the insolvency proceeding. We were advising Dalmia Cement at that time when they were trying to take over Binani Cement. The tussle was between Ultratech and Dalmia. So this was a case, as I said, of mergers, of a merger and acquisition. So at that time, the amendment in the law had not come to fore, and that's why people were not clear whether when they should go to CCI. So if you are a resolution applicant, when should you go and take CCI permission? Because you do not know whether your resolution plan will be accepted or not. You may not be the highest bidder. There was a typical case in this case. So Dalmia did not know whether it will be highest bidder because Ultratech was equally in fray. So they said, why should I spend the money? And you know, by the way, the fees are very high. For a merger filing from Form 1, fees are 20 lakh rupees in CCI just for filing. And for Form 2, it is 60 lakh rupees, sir. Apart from the fees which you pay to the lawyers and to the economist. Because they require a lot of economic research. Surveys are required. So this is what CCI is. I've just given you a broad overview. And now see the regulatory structure of Competition Commission of India, as I said, passed in 2003, enforced from 20th of May 2009. Section 6 was enforced later on from June 2011. So the main regulator is the Competition Commission of India, which can take up Suomoto cases also. By reading newspaper, it can take inquiries. The investigative powers are vested with the Director General, the DG. Appeals go to the NCLAT. Earlier, we had Competition Appellate Tribunal. Now we got National Company Law Appellate Tribunal. And of course, the second appeal, the RSA, goes to the Supreme Court of India. This is the structure. Lately, the DG has become quite active. And these are some examples of recently conducted dawn raids. So JCB started with the JCB in 2014. Then in Kolkata, we had the drug rice sale battery cartel 2016, beer cartel in Mumbai, pulse cartel in somewhere in West India, and tarpaulin cartel all over India. So these were companies which were raided, and their hard disk, they go and just, why do we call it down raid? Because they generally go into the morning, and they'll just go and knock into your company and enter your premises and take over whatever they can, incriminating evidence. So what would be those potential sources of evidence? You should be careful. So all your internal documents, MIVO, circulars, your emails, your hard drives, soft copies, your presentation copies, your board papers, agendas, phone records, expenses account, competitor document if you got in your position. Of course, oral evidence and even SMSs and WhatsApp. I gave an example of WhatsApp chats. People do not know they have a group called so-and-so. I'm defending a group of people who are in a particular in a particular sector. I would not name that sector because that will be very clear. So they had made this WhatsApp group called so-and-so. Suppose, for example, it's called paper. So everybody was in that group. And they were exchanging messages here and there. So when this one of them filed a leniency, by the way, how to break cartel is one of the methods. You go to the CCI and say, well, we agree we are in a cartel, please give us waiver of penalty. So you become the first leniency applicant and you get 100% you get. So the leniency was filed by somebody. So that person, that somebody, he became a government approver or approver, you know, like a government witness. And he gave all the documents to this DG. And all the chat came before the DT. So when the next people were called who denied that we are not in a cartel, so they were showed the whole chat box, you know, that, well, you are showing thumbs up, this is the rate, are you saying good? And once you quoted, here is your quote. So everything was very, very clear. So people don't know. That's why I got knife cartel. India got knife cartels. So when can you violate the law, sir? Let me be quick in this. So during rigging, for example, during bidding for supplies in public procurement to large customer or to PSUs, suppose you are interacting with your competitor, you are doing pre-bid discussion, exchanging price data, bid rigging, collusive bidding, market allocation, boycott, and for vertical descent, as I said, if you are indulging in any of these features which I just described very briefly, particularly the last one, controlling or monitoring discounts or imposing loyalty inducing rebates. I'll explain that loyalty inducing rebate if somebody has a question. So when can you violate for abuse of dominance? So if you have a large market share, if you are a company which has above 30% market share consistently, and you are discriminating between your customers, as I gave the example of DLF, unfair conditions, or your pricing policy which are below or above your cost, and you have unfair or one-sided conditions against the DLF case, have you ever refused to deal, do you restrict your customer choice in any manner, you impose supplementary obligations not connected with the main contract, and do you impose exclusivity? For the supplementary obligation, Dr. Prakash, I'll give you a very interesting recent example. So we had this case of Grasim Industries Limited. You know, recently Grasim Industries Limited has been penalized with 301 crore of penalty. You know what was the matter? Grasim Industries Limited is Aditya Birla Group company. It is a monopoly in viscous staple fibers, VSF. So viscous staple fiber is something which is used, you know, in the best quality of cotton shirts, etc. For example, you got Louis Philippe, Van Heusen, all those beautiful shirts which we normally wear, right? So this is the market for that. And this VSF is a very unique product. It's a man-made fiber. So Grasim is a monopoly in that. It has the maximum market share in this product. And whose are its customers? Its customers are spinners, you know, small spinners who use this yarn to make the products for the retailers, right? So what Grasim used to do was, since it was almost like a monopoly, it was a dominant player, it was making the sale of this VSF subject to certain peculiar conditions, which are never heard of. So unlike a normal supplier who will say that if you buy more of my product, I'll give you more discount. It's called volume-based rebates, right? It was the reverse. It was saying, I don't care how much you buy, because I know my product will be sold. It is how you use that product. And it has two categories. One was for domestic customers, and the other was for export-based customers. So if you are exporting your product, you will get more discount. And if you are using it domestically, you will get lesser discount, irrespective of the quantity you buy, right? And then another thing, it was asking for the spinners to give details of the way they use their product. So every month, in order to get discount for the next month's supply, you have to give your production details. How much I exported and how much I sold in the market. And third thing, it was not allowing the product to be sold in the open market. So there was no trading possible. So you cannot go to Grasim and say, I need 1,000 bales of VSF, please give it to me. They said, no, unless you have a license. Unless you are a spinner, we will not give to you. And even if you are a spinner, you must tell what you are going to use. So the open trading was not possible. So the spinners had no alternative. Either they could import, right, or they could go to Grasim. For import, Grasim also sought to make that anti-dumping duty was imposed on the poor, cheaper Chinese imports. Because under the anti-dumping law, if you are having more than 50% share, you can represent the industry. So Grasim represented before the ADD, and it was successful in getting anti-dumping duty imposed on that fiber from China. But at the same time, it was itself importing from where? From Thailand, from Indonesia, from its own subsidiaries based in those countries. So Birla Rayon was there in Thailand. They were a company based in Indonesia. From them, it was importing, right? And so it was controlling the entire spinner market completely. And for this classic case of imposing supplementary obligations on customers, the CCI imposed fine. This was a case of 42E, apart from, of course, unfair discounts. So the matter is sub judice. Since we are involved in this case, my views may be a little biased, but the fact remains, the spinners in India are destroyed. The people have closed their shops. I know companies which are going into insolvency, looking for resolution per CIRP process, because they have lost. Their employees have gone out of job. So this is the classic case of an abuse of dominance. I'm telling you, dominance in India, unlike cartels, we got galore. We got market dominance, absolutely, there's no limit. And after prosecuting this case, my eyes are open at least. DLF was also, I was involved, but this case is another example of it. So, please see, this is the, how can you violate the law if you're a dominant player? So now the last leg of my presentation, sir. So how can the knowledge of law help you in your business? So please note that if you know the law, so if your market shares are dwindling, or if you're losing profits, or if you're suddenly having losses in your business, it could be due to an anti-competitive conduct which you may not even perceive. So this slide of mine will give you some idea how to consult a competition lawyer and how to get rid of that problem. So please see very carefully. So for example, your raw material or input supplier suddenly increases prices without justification. Or all your raw material suppliers increase their prices collectively. We had another case of bearing case. So in what happened in the bearing case, sir, Dr. Prakash, the bearing companies, suddenly their steel price increased. So they wanted to increase the price of their product. They went to the OEMs. Who are their customers? Honda, or the Suzuki, all those big car companies. They said, sir, our prices have increased, steel price increased, aap dekh lijiye. You know what the company used to say? Well, you have come alone, the others have not come. There are only 4 or 5 companies in this market. Strict, tight, oligopoly, right? So they said, what to do? So they started talking to each other. Bhai, kya kare? The moment they started talking to each other, they had a meeting. One of these companies was a German or a European-based company. They understood antitrust at that time. They went to CCI. They filed a legal. So all rest of the companies became a sitting duck. It was a buyer's market. And they were accused of cartelization because they saw that their raw material suppliers are increasing price collectively. They couldn't do anything. So they talked to each other and they became a cartel. Of course, finally, the CCI found this. No, they have not imposed penalty on that case. Luckily, because they saw to it. So, but the law is there. So, and imagine the case of cement cartel. Now, how did cement cartel was busted? The Builder Association of India, when it found that the cement prices are increasing day by day, the builders of, they had an association, and this association went to CCI. And finally, cement cartel was busted. So, if you find that your suppliers are collectively increasing prices, sir, think of CCI. You may have a case, you may suddenly create history. So, you can find, when you find no competition, or when you find your supplier restricting discounts, when you find that your supplier is forcing you to buy your entire demand of raw material from him, or forcing to purchase large quantity as a condition precedent for granting the normal discount they gave up. I gave the example of Grasim. So, all your raw material refuses to supply, or your or suddenly your, because of your input cost, see how you lose profit is either the demand dwindles or your cost of production increases. So I'm addressing to the cost of production part. So your input is an important component of your profit, your input cost. So how can this law help you while cutting down your input cost is this. And further, your raw material input supplier adopt policies which cause business losses to you, and your target of boycott of competitors, if, for example, unfair clauses in the agreements, restrictive condition imposed by the large buyers, it is there. And even PSU, the last bullet, please see. Suppose you are a victim of conditions which are unique for you. You are only disqualified. It happens quite often because corruption cannot be ruled out in this country. There is plenty of corruption among the PSU buyers. So they will create conditions which will be so unique that only you are ruled out. Others are eligible to bid. There are many cases we have defended before the CCI. So that also you can think of competition law. If you have policies made by the government which are so one-sided that you can't even participate in tender bidding. I remember the Jindal case. So Jindal wanted to supply rails to the Ministry of Steel, Ministry of Railways. Ministry of Railways had a 30-year contract with the SAIL, Steel Authority of India Limited, Bhilai Steel Plant, for taking exclusively the entire demand of rails from SAIL. Jindal said, please open the market. You allow us also to bid. We also got equally good rails, 120 meter, 24 meter rails. We have the same product quality. Please consider us. The ministry refused. The Jindal went to CCI. So the point is that you can go to CCI on any aspect of your business which is hurting you, which you don't understand. And suppose you are a dealer. This was for manufacturers. So if you are a dealer, please have a look at these bullets quickly. So if your supplier actually is insisting that you resale, store or distribute only his product, exclusivity is there. And for example, it is increasing pricing restrictions on you, and unfair and restrictive conditions of supplies, nature of discounts are being controlled. suppose determine the maximum discount. We have had cases. Resale price maintenance is a very serious subject. We did a webinar on 29th August on this very subject recently last week, and I am open to questions. Time in arrangements. So when you and then when your supplier or manufacturer forces you to achieve high excessive sale targets as condition precedent for qualifying as an incentive scheme, like foreign tour schemes, you may have come across those cases. Or fidelity rebates, loyalty rebates, target discounts, or loyalty inducing rebates are there. So these bullets are very clear. I don't have to explain. Please go through them. And suppose if it's a dominant player imposing minimum resale price, then of course it is illegal. So whenever the supplier is a dominant player, please understand the possibility of foreclosure of the market is very strong. So there's a possibility of it being caused what is called appreciable adverse effect on competition. AAC is there. Or last one, you can see where the manufacturer was a dominant player refuses to provide warranty. There was a case. Or your product sold online, you know, so Flipkarts, etc. And then when your supplier, manufacturer, who's a dominant player, restricts your selling or designated area, which you asked me a question, or you asked me, market accreditation policies, minimum operating prices, or where any. Now, these three bullets are for people who want to sell their products online. So if any e-commerce platform restricts you from selling your products, maybe, or whether it controls the discount which you're going to offer over and over. There was a case of Snapdeal versus Kef Appliances. And whether any dominant enterprises like Amazon, etc., impose MFN clauses. The last one is important. So you've got these companies, I'm naming them because the cases are still on. Amazon, Flipkart, MakeMyTrip are still under investigation. Swiggy and Zomato are not. So imposes MFN clauses or white parity clauses as a precondition for taking you on board. That you will come on board only when you give me the best rates as compared to any other channel provider or any other website. Then you can take over competition commission. So with this, Dr. Prakash, I'm done with my presentation. Thank you for your kind attention. And I'm open to questions now.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sarmaji. Now I have some questions which have been coming in the chat box. One question is there any correlation between the patent and the competition? In the sense, you know, for example, a pharma company in the wake of Corona now comes up with a patent, life-saving drug. So whether the competition law will pitch in there?
This is the sir, I'm not clear. I'm sorry, it's not audible. It's not audible, sir. Can you repeat, sir? Can you repeat, please?
Yeah. I will repeat it now. Is it audible? Hello? Is it audible?
Yeah, it's better.
Yeah, now the question here is if a life saving drug is being owned by a company and they have a patent, whether the competition law will pitch in there, whether the patent or is there any correlation to patent and competition law?
Yes, that's a good question. So, when the drugs are protected by patents, they can sell the price they want because the patents are protected by the law. There is section 3, subsection 5, under which IPRs are granted protection subject to reasonable conditions being imposed. So, so long as the patents are valid, nobody can check your price unless that is they are included in the NELP, the National Essential List of Products, you know, unless they are drug controlled by the drug controller. Otherwise, if they are out of NELP or if they are out of those scheduled drugs, controlled drugs, then they can take any price they want. But after the life of the patent, after the patent has expired and still those drugs continue to be sold at their high prices, then certainly the commission can look into it. And by the way, we are going to have our next webinar on this very issue of pharmaceutical issues under the competition issues under pharmaceutical sector. And I would like to add to your knowledge that CCI has recently conducted a study in which it has actually highlighted those aspects of excessive pricing by the pharmaceutical companies. Because in India, we got a unique practice called branded generics. India is basically a generic market. All our companies are generic companies. We take the molecule API from the West and we produce generic drugs at cheaper prices, right? But after the, it so happens that when the life of the patent starts nearing to expire, it's 20 years, most of these originator companies based in Europe or America, wherever, they have a co-marketing agreement or co-promotion agreement. So they launch the same molecule with a different brand name, which will be similar to the brand in which it will be sold. to continue reaping so-called monopoly profits, and this is unique to India. So branded generics is a huge issue. In fact, when I went to Moscow, so this was very, very high. I highlighted this in my talks in the BRICS conference. I hope I'm able to answer the question.
Another question is distributorship. The distributor gives you 10% discount, but the manufacturer gives you 20% discount. How does it?
So discount you can give. See, manufacturer cannot restrict the discount which the distributor wants to give to the customer. Because if it is a, see, if you are principal to, if the business to business model, once you buy the product from the supplier, you become the owner of the product. You may have your own margin set, but after that, the price at which you sell to the product into the free, into the open market, should be freedom with the dealer. So dealer can give whatever price it wants as per the market forces. So the manufacturer cannot, that is what called resale price maintenance. That's what I gave the example of Hyundai. For example, of Maruti Suzuki, you cannot control the discount if you are a manufacturer of a product after selling the product for resale. If there is a resale, resale has to be as per market competitive prices. The dealer has to decide, subject to keeping the margins.
Sir, shall I ask Sir Seshagiri here? Can you hear me, sir?
You can show yourself, sir. We can ask people to show themselves if you want. I don't mind.
Okay.
So that we can see each other.
I'm changing the
video.
Yeah, video is open. See, a manufacturer where he fixes a 100 rupees price, where he gives the distributor 90 rupees. More than that, he cannot give discount. But manufacturer goes to the client directly. Since he has got the power, he will give 20%. But distributor got only 10% in his hand. He cannot go beyond that. Because that is the difference which manufacturers gives to him. He has to pay 90 rupees. But distributor get filled by the manufacturer in a different way, knowing the market client data. Is it allowed?
Yeah, well, it's not allowed. It's an anti-competitive behavior.
Okay. That is the manufacturer. They do lot of US company they do in India. Where they try to...
I'm aware of it, sir. I've advised that class company into this. So we know we don't want to name companies because they're sensitive subject, but this practice is quite prevalent in the glass sector. At least I know.
Okay.
It is wrong. Yeah, it is wrong. You can come to us and we can help you.
Thank you.
Sir, these petroleum products and oil prices, normally they are controlled by public sector or monopoly companies. So they fix their own price. How far it is, whether the competition law can take cognizance of that? Is a question by Ravichandran.
Yeah. So petrol prices are regulated by the government. So regulated prices, which are controlled by law, are not cartelized. They're not cartels. Cartels are where the company is free to act by your own choice. So IOCL, BPCL, and SPCL cannot be accused of being cartelized, cartelizing and fixing the price. Because the price is being fixed by the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas by law. So that will not be covered under the CCI because it is. But at the same time, I give you an example. Very good question because, so these three companies were accused of cartelization where? Reliance was a company which accused them of cartelization in the supply of jet ATF. So aviation turbine fuel was the product. So there was a competition between Reliance and these three PSUs. So Reliance went to CCI and said that wherever we are bidding for supplying to the civil aviation sector, right? The Airport Authority of India or the particular civil aviation players, whether it is Jet Airways or whatever at that time. So these three companies, they come together and quote a lower price. So we are out. So they were accused of cartelization there. And similarly, if you notice the case of PSU insurance cartel. So in the Kerala state, all the three PSU companies, Oriental Insurance, National Insurance, and whatever is there, the three, four companies, were colluding, to apply for a state health insurance product. With the state health insurance company, like now we got Arogya Bharat Mission, no? Prime Minister Modi has launched the Arogya Bharat Mission. Suppose to apply for that particular product in a particular state, if these three, four companies come together and quote the same price or fix the price, then it will be cartel. So these companies were accused of cartelization. They were penalized by CCI, despite the fact they claimed before the commission that we are controlled by the Ministry of Finance. It is the Finance Ministry which asks us not to compete. What do we do? So the Finance Ministry was asked to explain. That's what I said to you. So wherever it is possible, they do it, because wherever you are free to conduct your behavior. But where it is done by law, then it is not covered.
I have seen the penalties which you all the cases. It runs in several crores. What is the basis here? There is a question by one Mr. Rajesh. He is asking, what is the basis for such a huge penalty? How do they arrive at this kind of a penalty? It is all mind-boggling numbers you have shown.
Is the question related to the huge penalty which the commission can impose?
Yeah. So what is the basis the penalties arrived at? How does the commission arrive at that kind of penalties?
Yes, it's a good question. So I'll tell you, there is a cap of 10% of the turnover of the last three preceding years under the law. 27B very clearly says that the average of the turnover of the last three preceding year when the case is decided. But that is the total turnover. But now, after the Supreme Court judgment in the Excel Corp case, that has been decided that the penalty will be only on the relevant turnover. So if you're a multi-product company, the penalty cannot be on your entire business. The penalty will be on the product which is accused of being cartelized or in which you have committed the violation. So the basis is now set. It is the relevant turnover which decides the penalty of which is to be imposed. And it is of the last three preceding years. So it's not baseless. There are bases for that. But unlike the European Union or the other developed jurisprudence, there are no guidelines in the form of regulations for the penalties.
These kind of penalties looks like the company itself will get killed.
Yes, it is possible. The companies itself can go, because see, these small companies, as I said, many companies have been wiped out because of the huge penalties CCI used to impose earlier. But that was a time, Dr. Om Prakash, when relevant turnover concept had not come, by the way. That concept came over only later. So earlier in 2011-12, which I'm telling of the LPG case, which I was a part, there was no relevant turnover concept. So huge total turnover 10%, and the entire profit is gone. Not only profit, you end up earning of the company. So now, of course, there's a little bit of solace.
Any questions from the audience? Shama is available before closing or going to the water. Thanks. If any questions are there, please shoot.
Sir, you note down my details on the bullet on the last slide. You can note down my email ID, my blog, and my mobile number also. I've left. Normally, I don't give my mobile number. So, if anybody has to contact me, you can do that at this contact details.
Sure. So we will now wrap up the session by vote of thanks. I thank everybody who has come here and participated in this webinar. It was a wonderful session. Thank you, Mr. Sharmaji, for spending time with us and also explaining in detail about the competition law. It is an eye-opener, actually. As you said, it can even destroy a company if they are neglecting or going on their way. But only thing is, the awareness is not there in the mainstream companies. I think a lot of awareness should be done. That is what I find. And I think we have not done a good justice. A lot of people have not come today. I can, with a note, I'll circulate to other members, and on demand, I can try to organize again a meeting if people want. There are some colleagues, Mr. Sheshagiri says, really, it was a very good session. Thanks, Sheshagiri, for being candid and asking several questions, and also Ravichandra. Thank you very much. And thank you, everybody who has come here. I thank the BCIC Secretariat, Mr. Prithvi, Shyam, Rupa, and all of them for cooperating and making this success even successful. With this note, I think I will conclude this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Om Prakash sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. It was a wonderful session. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.